a topic so that there is every reason for making a shock noise, and why don't I get Bob McNamara's people to do it?
Well, if they would just, somebody would say that
it's unfortunate to have this aid and comfort given to...
not aid and comfort, just say it's a thought of thing which is involves intelligence, which is the last thing ought to be discussed this way, and
this
kind of Senator Goldwater...
This kind of disclosure is helpful to the people in Cuba, yeah.
Well, the only thing, I suppose, that confirms it, doesn't it?
Well, no, this, I mean, discussion of it can only be helpful.
To our enemies and Senator Goldwater, who certainly should, as some of the Armed Services Committee should know that, but some... Anonymous Defense Department.
Yeah.
Say that?
Yeah, I think so.
Hello.
Mr. President, on the 2 points you raised this morning, I talked to General Carroll of DIA, who says we have no new equipment on our electronic intelligence aircraft. It's simply the typical electronic intelligence equipment, which is sensitive to electronic emanations and perhaps could pick up generators associated with SAM sites, for example. In any case, it's a violation of security. So I called General LeMay, who is a close friend of Goldwater's, and I asked him to get in touch with Goldwater and handle it directly. And we're also going to try to get a senator on the Armed Services Committee to say in the Senate that this is a violation of security.
Very good.
Handle it that way. Now, secondly, on the Ward article, we will brief Ward as well as other newspaper correspondents on a background basis as to the difference.
Hello. Please leave a message after the tone.
Aloha. How you doing, Devils? This is Barack Hussein Obama. I just wanted to call and congratulate Michael Brooks, Michael Jamal Brooks, Matt Leck, Dave Slavik, David Grisham. You classed your first 1,000 patrons on Patreon. I knew that investing in you Devils was the right call. There is a place that you can find for yourselves in the new Nubian Mecca we're constructing, just so long as you remember your rightful positions. Now, I've told you the secret plan, and I think you're all familiar. Other things you should know. Bill Cosby, innocent. Louis Farrakhan, secret Jew. We're going to out him. And Donald Trump, not part of the plan, but pretty fucking funny. So anyways, I want to congratulate everybody. Thank you. I look forward to more degrading of the white man and various socialist schemes that come out of your Brooklyn delusions before we create the next divine Mecca. And stay away from our women. I'm just kidding, Devil. Enjoy yourselves. Until that moment, Allahu Akbar.
Welcome to the Michael Brooks Show. We're broadcasting from Brooklyn, where left is best. On today's program, of course, we have super producer Matt Leck.
Hello.
Head theoretician David Grisham. He's high on the button. He's ready.
How's it going?
How's it going? It's going good, David. And of course, super producer David Slavik, roaming the Twitter sphere, the Discord, all other facets of the Michael Brooks digital universe. On today's program, Anoa Changa, Michael Brooks Show crew, we're talking about a recent trip she made to Puerto Rico, the situation on the ground there, and future prospects, the message from the grassroots as we head into 2018 and face more democratic failure, but also more bottom-up opportunity. And then Anthony Lappé, showrunner, filmmaker, journalist, he's joining me. We're talking about the hidden history of the opioid crisis, the poppy fields of Laos, the CIA, Purdue, the family behind OxyContin, and the role that marijuana legalization and the Sinaloa cartel played in creating the opium crisis, the opioid crisis as we know it. Then he's going to hang out for the post game. But first, let me get to this week's commentary. The Democrats caved. they picked a really weak position in shutting down the government over actions to protect the Dreamers. Now, let's be really clear about this. This failed by two pretty key metrics. One metric is the integrity metric of holding government shut down until at least some bare minimum of action is taken to protect a classified Dreamers who are being terrorized as part of this administration's larger war on immigration, this administration's larger push for abuse and white supremacy. That was the moral push, as well as the strategic one, because ultimately a broader, more multicultural America is in fact going to be advantageous to any type of center-left cohesion. Then they also messed up on purely cynical political grounds. So in other words, if you're going to make this move, you should actually make it. And if you know that you don't have the follow-through to make this move, then don't make it. Cut that deal out of the gate and don't embarrass yourself. Now, a lot of people have made this point, and there's also been some spin to sort of counter it. And I'm aware they got a six-year extension on CHIP. Incredibly important. Theoretically, Republicans even have said that they support the Children's Health Insurance Program, although I'm sure they would have let it die on the vine. That's what they got. There were some human stakes involved. But the broader strategic failure is stark and clear for anybody who's in any way sound enough to see it. But to me, it also points to this deeper crisis of just a fundamental asymmetry of perception between a stagnant technocratic leadership, completely out of step with the world as it is, and a relentless, totally reality bending far right populism that is embodied in the Trump administration, the modern Republican Party. Let's take a clip. This is from Living in a Unreal World, which was a short film that Adam Curtis put together for Vice. Check out the intro to this.
This is the normal world. You go to work in a city. All around you are enormous new buildings. They look alike. But you will never be able to afford to live in them, because they are not really homes. They are blocks of money bought by global investors whose money has nowhere else to go. Brexit happened. It showed that all the people who are supposed to tell you about the world, the journalists, the politicians, the think tank experts, know nothing. It showed that they and you live in a dream world, detached from reality. You spend your days and nights on social media. The original vision was that it was going to open up a new paradise where information was shared freely. But now, the algorithms are so strong and know so much about you that they only give you what they know you like.
This is the world we're living in. And this is why this kind of false sense of expertise and the small bore tactics of the Democratic Party are not only wrong in a traditional political sense. Even if we were playing by 1990s rules, this would be a failure. It identifies once again both the lack of commitment to actual material outcomes, because of course there's this other sense that the Democrats have articulated, implicitly at least, that yes, if nothing happens to protect DACA, people protected under DACA, then this can be a winning issue in 2018. This can actually come through in some way for electoral benefit. There's no actual material conviction, which is the only way to counteract this sense of unreality. But then conversely, if we're playing in the realm of unreality, Trump and the Republicans, who make up reality as they go along, who have a totally fluid relationship to institutions, who don't play by any of these small point scoring games, are still owning the landscape, even as they're immensely unpopular. So this failure in this cave of the Democrats is wrong on the ethics. It's wrong on the strategy. And it also points to the fact that in a broader, even just world we live in sense, these people don't get it. Just like they don't understand, and Anthony and I will talk about later, that when Trump talks about carnage all over America, yes, he's cueing xenophobia. Yes, he's cueing bigotry. And when liberals respond with, well, actually, statistically, the crime rates are down, they're ignoring the fact that he is talking about specific pockets, specific areas in the periphery where crime and violence have, in fact, skyrocketed. Until they can play in an unreal world and try to make it real through actually delivering for people, they're going to be at a structural disadvantage with only brief bits of respite where they win by default because Republicans have created such an awful reality themselves. And that is the depressing and cold reality as I see it. We are contemplating making an Adam Curtis documentary ourselves. We were working on one earlier. What were we talking about?
I forget. We were saying where losing is winning and winning is not for you.
When winning's for the other guy. The music has to drop and then the subway, like the escalator goes to the bottom of the subway and then like Vivaldi comes on. And then it's like, we live in an incoherent world. Up is down and down is up. But where are you? Not in the middle. We want to take some time now to go to this shout out. This is going to be a little bit of a longer than usual shout out because Bernie Sanders, we're going to actually head over briefly. He's holding a Medicare for All town hall right now. And talk about injecting reality into politics. The reality that we need a mass universal based systems. We need a socialism. Thank you. I know Bernie's a very big fan of the song. Where's my intro music, you little pricks? This is the basic recognition that the way to win and avoid silly culture wars, the way to have a strategy to defeat oligarchy, to have a strategy to defeat neoliberals, to have a strategy to defeat fascists, is going to be grounded in serious universal delivery, healthcare, housing, education. I feel like that Klubeck guy.
Keep it simple. Give everyone healthcare.
No bumps.
No bumps.
No bumps in the road.
No, the road. Rip rich people out of their houses. Strip them of their assets. Keep it simple.
Steal their hood ornaments.
Steal their hood ornaments. Put them into prison and re-education camps. Keep it simple.
That's definitely a new character. Gulag Klubeck, where he just all of a sudden gets it.
Take away their money. Have a financial revolution that's really a cultural revolution.
We need to send them underground.
Make it socially poisonous to be wealthy. Keep it simple. Be humiliated, socially ostracized. Burn down their ski condos. Keep it simple. Connect the tactics of Earth First with the politics of the Internationale before it was watered down by the Third Way. Keep it simple. Class politics today, class politics forever. Keep it simple.
All right. And with that introduction, let's take a couple of minutes to check into Bernie Sanders' Medicare for All, our healthcare crisis town hall. Yeoman's work by the great Comrade Bernie Sanders right now.
Or late afternoon, so that she could continue to work. Because what she knew was that if she couldn't continue to work, she wouldn't be able to pay her bills, including her rent. And if she couldn't pay her bills, nothing else mattered. So what we see is that we have studies that show that people who do not have insurance delay in seeking care for heart attacks, that people who have co-payments for medication, no matter how low, it decreases the utilization of much needed medications, decreases the uses of blood pressure medicine, decreases the use of diabetic medication and cholesterol lowering statins. We know that the higher the copayment, the poorer the outcome for children with asthma. So we need to make healthcare a right in this country. The reality is that we already spend enough money on healthcare in this country. We just allow too many people who are not involved in the delivery of health care to take profit from it.
Let me ask a question. Tell me if I'm wrong, but I expect some of the people who actually walk in your door do have health insurance, but their deductibles and copayments are so high they can't get to the doctor when they need it. Would that be true?
That's exactly right. So when you see someone who has health insurance, but their deductible is 10% of their income, $35,000 a year with a $3,500 deductible, that's not insurance. And so the problem we have is people who don't have access to medications. We provide access to medications for our patients.
Now, when we talk about a dysfunctional healthcare system and a wasteful system, tell me about people who walk in your door much later than they should have and end up a great expense to the system, not to mention suffering, in the hospital. Does that take place as well?
So the patients that I gave you examples of were all examples of people who would have been much cheaper to take care of them earlier on. That cook would have been able to continue working if he could have his afford his blood pressure medication. That gentleman with diabetes got very sick, or the salesman who had uncontrolled hypertension and got kidney failure, he could have continued to work and not need dialysis if he had controlled his blood pressure.
So you see people who are walking into your door a lot later than they should?
Every day. Every day. It is what fills our emergency room. It burdens our clinics. We find it's much easier to control the blood pressure than to pay for the rehabilitation after your stroke.
Right. And that's one of the crazinesses of the system. We pay after at 10 times more than we spend rather than preventing the crisis in the first place.
The preventive care is far cheaper.
Okay. Deborah Wachtel is a nurse practitioner outside of in Burlington, Vermont. Deborah, you and I were discussing an issue that is probably the issue of most concern to the American people in terms of health care, and that is the high cost of prescription drugs. When somebody walks into your office and they get a prescription for medicine, how often does it happen that then they're unable to get that prescription filled that the doctor prescribed?
Right. Well, in our case, it's
hold up my close to your mouth.
Hold it close. In our case, it's the nurse practitioners, because we have a nurse practitioner practice. And whether you're a nurse practitioner, a physician, a PA, when we prescribe medications for patients, it becomes a circus. So one patient might walk in with insurance and their copay is $4, and they walk out very happy. The next patient who has the identical medical issues and has insurance, their insurance company makes them pay $1,200 for the same medication that another patient would pay $4 for. My day is spent seeing patients, but interjected throughout my day is phone calls from pharmacists with rejection after denial.
Welcome back. Yeah, so Bernie Sanders is doing it. I mean, look, this is it. And this is the work at all levels. Any politician, any organizer, work that we're contributing to, work in this, any part of the ecosystem that is saying, look, socialism is not... And any type of left politics, it's not a niche. It's not about being trendy. It's not about having an internal dialogue. It's not about knowing all the lingo. It's not about how proving how woke you are. It is about the mass, humane treatment and radical economic democracy and delivery for people. And he's doing that. Medicare for all is vitally important because it is the tip of the spear for disrupting the chokehold that capital has in all of our lives and the inherent violence. You know, anytime you talk to some libertarian fantasist and they're talking about coercion, ask them who has more coercion in their, what is the most coercive relationship in their life? Now, chances are they are some type of, you know, parent-dwelling, aspiring entrepreneur. But if they have a job and they're answering honestly, they're going to say their boss. They're not going to say some government agency that they've made up some freaked out story about. And to the extent government agencies are abusive, to the extent the IRS focuses on terrorizing lower income people, while the wealthy get away with evading massive amounts of taxes and accountability. That's because the system is stacked for the oligarchs. The rules are written for the incumbents. And that's not an indictment of our shared democratic endeavors. That's an indictment of our small clique of economic concentrations and sclerotic misdistribution, which is choking out innovation, democracy, life, and basic goodness. Now we're going to do a brief pitch here, and then we'll get to Anoa Changa. But as always, really props. I mean, Bernie Sanders and Jeremy Corbyn, they stayed, they're like Obi-Wan Kenobi figures. They stayed in the wilderness while these other people embraced the third way and all sorts of garbage. I thought we were doing Bad Boy for Life, but this works. I always, every time I think of Dipset, I have Bill Clinton in my mind. It's like, Dipset, Dipset, Dipset. Works. We crossed 1,000 patrons. Thank you. Is the board up? You ready for this mashup? Dipset meets... Oh, wow. The shofar totally overpowered it.
Bring it back down in the mix.
Yeah. Dipset, Dipset. All right. Wait, oh, you ready? Oh, that... That actually sounds kind of hot. I like that. Thanks to all of you. Thanks to everybody that's made it happen. Obviously, this is a first of many goals. Getting past 1,000 is going to allow us to sustain ourselves, build out our first set of animations, which we're starting. Make sure on Patreon at the end of the month that your card and information is up to date. That's really important to keep getting content. Make sure that the money flows properly. There's always a pretty big drop off, and a lot of that is because of things like declines and stuff. And there's a ton of offerings. You get way more services as a patron. You get at least double the content. You have a thriving Discord community. At 21 and above, you have those intensive calls with me, the real in-depth analysis. Stay tuned for animation. Stay tuned for Wolfenstein. I haven't forgotten about that. I'm going to LA this week. Got a bunch of stuff going on out there with DYT, with my brother Waz, and all sorts of other great people. Hunter Motz, Christopher Ryan, Daniele Bellelli. It's very exciting. I appreciate all of you. Please become a patron. This is how we win. This is how we fight the larger war. We're profoundly committed to this project, and it is simply not possible without you. And you are really the only ones that I want to have make it possible. I don't want to be accountable to anybody else. So thank each and every one of you so much. We will be right back. Patreon.com/TMBS. We're on the move. Keep moving with us. We'll be right back with Anoa Changa. Welcome back to the Michael Brooks Show. Yeah, man, that thing is stuck. That Bill Clinton, Dipset, Dipset. That's definitely like 90s aught humor. It works, though. It works. Even I could tell even Anoa thinks it works. Joining us now is Michael Brooks Show crew and host of The Way with Anoa. She is one of the most brilliant minds in American politics and a recent guest on the BBC World Service, Anoa Changa. Thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, that was an awesome introduction. Thank you. The BBC was like the highlight. I mean, that was sweet.
That was very sweet. I loved it. But I loved watching it. I loved watching the anchor.
It's not as amazing as being here with you, though. So, yeah,
well,
you know.
Of course not. I mean, this is the root. But that was very cool. Like, oh, no, Oprah Winfrey. And you go, no.
Well, real quickly, like, wanted Dr. West. And the person who was doing Dr. West's booking, he didn't want to do it. He's like, I don't want to talk about that. So they were like, well, do you know anyone else? And she was like, yeah, I know this attorney. She's pretty dope. Let me connect you. And so that's how I got to be on the BBC. Dr. West didn't want to talk about Oprah. So I got to do it.
That's awesome. Although that is really funny. I like that, like, Dr. West will take on anybody, anytime, anywhere, any place. And he's just like, no, not Oprah. Forget it.
He's like, it's not. He said it wasn't worth his time.
Yeah, it's not worth it. It isn't worth his time. I appreciate that Dr. West has better things to do than that. I buy it completely. Anoa, you just spent time in Puerto Rico. Mm-hmm. You were with a grassroots, you know, reconstruction and action group there. I guess, like, from both ends, just kind of give us an update, both in terms of, like, I know you saw some very, the type of inspiring stuff that we're promoting and talking about and you are so in touch with all the time. And then, of course, like, you know, the vultures are out for a place that they never left.
Like, it was an amazing experience because, you know, we know intellectually that Puerto Rico is, you know, Puerto Rico, Puerto Ricans are Americans. That's still us too over there, right?
Yep.
But, like, still, once you go there, and you see, and it's just like the feeling that you have in terms of when we look at any of our communities here stateside that are left behind, it's similar, but it's on just a larger scale because it's an entire, you know, island, it's an entire country full of people that in many respects have been completely disinvested, decimated, and left behind by the United States government. I mean, that's the legacy of colonialism in Puerto Rico. Yeah. What was cool with the group that I went with, they had did relief efforts back in October into September, like when people were first able to go over. They raised money, they took supplies over, and they rented vehicles and went up into the mountains where FEMA had not gotten to people and were delivering goods. So what we did when I went last month, we followed up with the communities and the people that they had met on their first two trips. We went back kind of to follow up and to start, they're in the process of doing a documentary now to kind of document that mutual aid relief work, that grassroots assistance work, because so much of what's getting done for people is still people helping people, whether it's neighbors, whether it's, you know, actual nonprofit groups, grassroots groups. That's so much of what's getting done, because when we were there last month, there were still warehouses of supplies sitting there that weren't being distributed to people. Like, we would ask folks every time we went to us, like, so have you guys seen FEMA? And they're like, we'll see the FEMA sign. You know, they might have come by here once, but for the most part, it was, and you know, some folks have lost everything, right? You know, you have people still living in houses that have no roofs or walls, but they're still going to make sure that the elderly neighbor down the road has food. Like, it was an amazing spirit. And the, just quickly, two places we went. We went to Humacao. There's a village up in the mountains. They were, well, the village is Mariana, but there was the area where they were feeding upwards of, like, I think at the height of things after Maria, they were feeding like 300 to 500 people a day off donated food. And they're really looking at a sustainable model. They have solar panels up there now. They had a group donated 2 water towers to the area so they could have fresh water instead of having to go buy bottled water. And they're really trying to create something that's long term. So not just responding to the crisis that was the aftermath of the hurricane, but something that's even longer and more sustainable for people. As folks may have seen, the governor is now talking about privatizing the electric company, which is it has its own issues on both sides. But that was a really rewarding experience to talk to the folks, you know, working, organizing there. And then we were also in another smaller town where this smaller community, people, about 25 families, were cut off from the main part of the town because there was a bridge that connected them to the other side. The bridge was completely wiped out by Maria. And so they were stuck on the other side of a river. And so they had to ford over, or they had to, like, use kind of like a zip line type of thing to send over supplies. So there's a local construction company helped make a makeshift bridge. Now they're finally, I think some folks from Boston are helping them build a brand new bridge. But their mayor, like, helicoptered in, said some words, and really hadn't done anything. Mm. It was the people in the town who would caravan over and find a way to send goods over. When we were there last month, there were still some family members of the people for that were the initial group that were trapped, the camp of, they called them the camp of the forgotten. There was another section not too far away that was trapped behind a mudslide still. People could climb out, but the town, the area itself was still trapped behind a mudslide. So these are the things that we were seeing, but you would expect, like, with such devastation, with such, you know, we're still now at 30, I think it's 33% of the island still does not have power. Mm-hmm. You know, like, you would hear, like, when we were there, they were talking about, like, oh, the grid is like 60% up. Well, even at 60, 70% of the grid up, you still had 50% or more of the population when we were there last month without power. Both houses we stayed in had no power. There was generator access. And that's a privilege to be able to use a generator. Having run a generator in West for a week, it's expensive.
Yeah.
It's really expensive.
No, it's very expensive. Months, yeah.
To do it for months is insane. And so some of the places we met, some of the places that we went that we're wondering, you know, with some of the adjustments that have been made. I know they found a stockpile of equipment that was never dispersed like it was supposed to be recently. But, like, people were saying when we were there that they weren't expecting to get power back till July of this year, you know, from what happened in September of last year. So
what was the name? Just, I have a quick follow-up question. But
yeah,
first, what was the name of the group you were with?
The original group was... oh God! Yes.
No, it's fine. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it.
Because it was just some organizers from the original group.
Oh, got you.
I'll give you guys.
No, that's fine. I just want to make sure we have info and tweet out like if there's a ways of people to link up and support these efforts.
Yeah, I have tons of links to share and stuff.
Okay, so we'll include some of those in the show notes and tweet them out on Twitter and everything.
Definitely.
The question
but
I have,
but I just will say real quickly, there are so many of these efforts. People were raising money for solar panels for hospitals. People are raising money. There's like several different organizations stateside, nonprofits that are raising money for direct support on the ground outside of the government assistance and funding that isn't really going, at least it seems like, to the masses of people across the island where it needs to.
Do you feel like, and I think it was Rebecca Solnit, I could be mispronouncing her name, and I apologize if I am, but she wrote a book several years ago where she took Katrina and I think a couple other examples of crisis, and her argument was that in a lot of examples of human catastrophe, I think she focused primarily on things like hurricanes and floods, you know, things that were not human created, things that were inflicted by nature, where there was a lot of harm and disruption to people's lives, that while there is a public narrative and a media focus that, you know, okay, like things are bad, so, you know, the bad guys come out and, you know, and there's violence and people get stuck up and people, you know, and the sort of the strong prey on the weak and everything, that actually at least, and that is, you know, true on a policy level, right? There's always the opportunity. I mean, we saw what vultures do to New Orleans after Katrina or to Puerto Rico. But her argument was that on a community level, communities actually, people actually do a lot of what you saw in Puerto Rico, that people actually support each other a lot. People actually have a lot of sort of bottom-up ingenuity and compassion and solidarity. And I think one part of it to me that always struck me is that, you know, for a broader support for the politics that we want, not in a naive way, not in a saccharine way, but we need to have some pretty strong faith in human capacity. And I was just wondering, you know, what your sort of thoughts are on that type of sentiment after, you know, this experience in Puerto Rico and seeing like the vultures, the failures of government, the abuse, the exploitation, but the communities, people doing right.
Well, I think even when we look at like historically, like we look at development of previously depressed or underserved areas, right?
Yeah.
Just look at regular gentrification. Mm-hmm. Then you add on a either environmental or something that was man-made, some type of disaster. It's like people might joke about it, but it really is real. The land grab that happens, the way people, you know, come in and swoop down, because I forget what the numbers were, but like the number of people who were leaving Puerto Rico daily has been like huge. And that's a huge drain on the human capital and potential to revitalize and bring things back. Right.
Right.
But at the same time, when the resources are not being put into the people, when people don't even have a say, because you have PROMESA, you have so many different layers of oppression financially, among other things, right? Economic oppression on the silent as well, you know, it does create a condition that's ripe for quote unquote investors or other folks to come in and swoop down, buy a property, push people out. You know, I changed my Twitter name. This goes into this to Adolfina Villanueva. And Adolfina Villanueva was killed, was murdered by the state in 1980 for refusing to cede her land. The land had been in her family. We were in Luisa, Puerto Rico. That's an area that was settled by former enslaved Africans and their descendants, along with Tainos. And, you know, Adolfina, they had beachfront property. And they wanted to do slum clearance. They wanted to clear everyone out and develop the area. But she was murdered basically for standing her ground and not and refusing to let them put her family out of the area. Because of that, that community is still there now because of her stand. But like, this is historical, right? It's exacerbated now because of Maria, you know, what happened with Katrina after New Orleans after Katrina, like it gave people the ability to do what they've already been putting the design on communities that they feel are not deserving to have proximity to particular goods or areas. So I think that's a really fair way of looking at it. It's problematic, but it's more of a reason why we need strong bottom up support and mutual aid, not just in a time of crisis, but long term, so we can start turning and creating sustainable, you know, ability for us to maintain space and community.
And maybe expand space. I mean, maybe start to reverse, Absolutely. You know, all of this encroachment, all of this primitive accumulation, and actually sort of restake community commons and collaboration. I mean, because that's, you know, because I feel like the other thing, and it feels counterintuitive to frame it this way, but one of the things that I've been thinking a lot about recently is that even though, of course, like, we're under unbelievable stress, and, you know, and of course, you know, that descends to zones like we're talking about Puerto Rico, I mean, ripe for even more exploitation. And this is a place that is absolutely, and I want to be very clear about this, this is not... It's historically colonized. It's presently colonized. There are literal legal economic impediments to its own ability to perform economically. And it does not have the opportunity to either have independence or full statehood. So that's not like, you know, historical recognition or, you know, campus articulation. That's literally what it is. And there's an opportunity for all sorts of vulture capital to come in right now, there's no doubt. Yet at the same time, I think it's also very important for us to also articulate that, you know, ultimately our task is not just resistance. We actually want to develop a world that, you know, is reflected in these communities, so that these communities, these same capacities can come through in moments of incredible stress, come through in moments to, you know, create community, create sports, create art. You know, we look even at historical, you know, social democratic experiments that did have some success in places like Sweden or Germany, or community efforts, you know, in Jamaica. And if we're being real, some efforts in agriculture and other things in Cuba. Those things were about, like, you know, everybody should have good gymnasiums. People should have, you know, access to art. People should have, you know, clubs and community. These things kind of coming together are vital for resistance, but they're also potentially an enactment of a more, you know, really open and democratic world across all spheres.
Absolutely agree. I mean, I think that as we continue to think about, like, even what I looked at over there and thinking about, you know, the folks who I was with and thinking about our own work, right? Mm-hmm. We've crowdfunded a presidential campaign, basically, yeah. Right? Yep. We're supporting progressive candidates all over the country. There's grassroots activism organizing that's starting to take hold and take root. And a lot of what we've been able to do is without some big, you know, donor, yep. just growing it. So how can we continue to look at the mutual aid model and not just simply in a time of crisis when we have to hurry up and get resources because people are in desperate, dire need, but how do we leverage that, like we were just talking about, and expanding space and building community and actually driving sustainable change the way we need to see it versus waiting for whatever group to come in, which oftentimes they're more extractive of resources and human capital than they are actually, you know, actually investing into these communities where we're all living. But, you know, the other thing I was just thinking about is I was talking with H-Rap Brown's son. H-Rap Brown is formerly H-Rap Brown, Imam Jamil. His son was saying he lives over in the West End Community Historic Neighborhood here in Atlanta. And he was talking about the idea of gentrification. Mm-hmm. And gentrification is something that does not have to happen to us, right, is what he was talking about. And he was talking about basically a similar type of thing of people pooling their resources, you know, kind of like what immigrants used to do back in the day. You know, you come over, you work hard, you pool your resources, mm-hmm. and that's how you start building your ground. And I think that for marginalized communities that have had a very different relationship economically with this country, we need to redevelop the way in which we're approaching how land and development is handled within our communities. And so we need to look at new models instead of just trying to assimilate into the American dream model, because it doesn't include us. It wasn't meant for us. So we have to think smarter and outside of the box and find a way to do what needs to be done while saving space, because there's no reason, you know, for families to be displaced from communities they've been in for generations.
And it's, by the way, it's going to include less and less of us as that pie becomes smaller. So the time is Absolutely. Really for every single person to, and every single community, and also us collectively, to really reevaluate that model. As a final thought, and obviously we're going to talk again very soon, and it's been too long. We finally got to hang out a couple months ago, which was dope.
We finally got to hang out, and I will definitely let you know when I'll be in D.C. definitely in April, but I'll let you know when I'm coming to New York too.
So, because I don't go to D.C., so you're going to have to come to me. D.C.'s lame. Much love to D.C. patrons. But,
no, I have a meeting. I'm on the board of the National Conference of Black Lawyers, and we have an in-person meeting in D.C., so that's why I'm going.
I love the black lawyers. I love them. They do.
These are radical revolutionaries who represented Angela Davis and the like back in the late 60s and early 70s.
Yeah, so. Sure. I bet you don't like Mueller either. totally terrible guy. I saw what they did with COINTELPRO. Horrible stuff. Totally unfair. I'm a victim of COINTELPRO in a certain sense. I like that. Black socialist sympathizer Trump. As you look out across the terrain, and you mentioned it, and you're so clued into all of the, like when you talk about these insurgencies and these movements and these community buildings and these radical politics, you're not just sort of like, you know, name checking. You're on the pulse of it, and you cover most of this so well. When you look at 2018 and we look at the juxtaposition of the Democrats, you know, they just embarrassed themselves with this gambit, which, you know, it's so frustrating, Anoa, because it also failed by, like, you know, at least guys like Clinton and Blair, they knew how to fuck their enemies up. Yeah. And these guys don't know how to, like, they don't have the moral passion, and they also don't have that ruthlessness. And it's
just, they don't have the balls. Like, they don't know how to balls to follow through.
Yeah. Exactly.
Oh, wait, see, we have a little thing we did with PA.
No heart, no balls.
Some of the PA folks did a little thing. We did a little PA mixtape. Give the Dems a backbone mixtape. And one of my contributions was Nuck If You Buck. You know, I'm in Atlanta now, so I gotta represent for the A.
Schumer's like, I don't know what that means, but I think that black people are very nice. But when you look, Jesus, besides those people at the top fucking up, when you look at this broader terrain, and, you know, and you have smart critiques of Bernie, but I do feel like, you know, always got to give Bernie some props, because to me, he's still the only one at the top level.
Right,
yeah.
Streaming, right?
Yes.
Talking about healthcare.
Talking about healthcare. We played it before. Like, he's delivering. What else is happening across the country where people are just, you know, making these moves and acting with the heart and the balls and the backbone and the and the ratchet music to move forward?
Yeah, I mean, like, yeah, you need some backbone. Like, I was just thinking about, like, music that got me amped, and Ben and some other folks chimed in or whatever. We were like, we are so ratchet. But, like, this is the hype, and you got to go fight the enemy.
Yes.
Like, you need some hype music.
Yes.
You can't be like, oh, McConnell promised that we talk about it later. You sound like a girl waiting for her boy to propose after.
Yeah, I was
like
gonna say
years.
Not fiance. Well, that's a pre-fiance conversation.
like it was really bad. And again, like thinking about you know, how do we build these movements? How do we do this work? Because there's so much across the board, state level, that we need to work on as well as the larger federal issues. And I know people don't like the word incremental or incrementalism, but we really need to look at, like, small chunks, winnable things.
Yep.
We're still working towards the longer term, bigger picture goal. But if we start also getting some smaller term, actual, like, wins under our belt too, that helps us feel good. You get more confidence. Yes. You start building more of a collective, and you keep moving forward to the larger goal. Whether that larger goal is the complete decimation and takeover, the complete decimation of the Democratic Party, complete takeover, or something completely different, whatever that is, you need to clarify and be purposeful. But we really got to, like, you know, pull ourselves together and really start upgrading ourselves. You know, listen to some Beyonce, y'all.
Dipset
on my list.
Come on, I'm ready. I got this. Joel Santana.
Yeah, yep. Like Killer Cam. See,
Killer Cam.
They just need to listen to Killer Cam, and they'll be okay. They would have Mitch McConnell. What really bothers
me? Hey, Kanye, is this that 70s hair on flow?
What really bothered me, though, about the 72, the 60-hour shutdown, was the fact that in 2013, Ted Cruz threw a damn hissy fit about the ACA.
Yes.
There was nothing to negotiate on. It was settled law. They had no ground to stand on. And yet, and still, Ted Cruz and House Republicans, because remember, Ted is in the Senate, he went and talked to the dopes over in the House to get them to have a shutdown.
Yep.
And for 16 days, they held the government, you know, at a standstill and came out with nothing.
Because they don't care. But they came out with a win in the sense of their momentum and their way to push the ball forward. And that's what these fucking nerds need to get. Anoa Changa, The Way with Anoa, Michael Brooks Show crew, thanks a million. I can't wait to talk with you soon. I know I'll be on your show soon.
You will be on my show soon, and we have business to discuss. So
yes.
Peace, my brother. Love you.
Love you, too. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right, folks. We're going to get to the pyramid in a second, but let's take a couple more minutes of the Bernie Medicare town hall. Then we'll do the pyramid, and then Anthony Lappé is going to join us.
Taxes. Well, it is true that many people, not all, will pay more in taxes. But if I told you today that instead of paying $10,000 a year or $15,000 a year for private insurance, you would have to pay $5,000 or $7,000 more for comprehensive health care for your whole family, what most Americans would say is, where can I sign up? So my Republican colleagues think it is somehow godly to be paying incredibly large amounts of money to insurance companies. That's good. That's wonderful. But somehow it is terrible to be paying somewhat more in taxes. Bottom line is that when we spend twice as much per capita on healthcare as any other nation, we could substantially lower the cost of healthcare in America, which drives down the cost per capita, which means that we are spending less. Right now, we have the absurd situation where in the last year, the largest five pharmaceutical companies in America made $50 billion in profit. $50 billion in profit at a time when millions of Americans cannot afford the health insurance that they desperately need and cannot afford the medicine that they need. So the issue is whether or not we join every other country on earth and talk about a national healthcare system, or we continue our dysfunctional system. Now,
I shouldn't have ranted for that long, but let me throw it back to our distinguished panel. Richard?
Senator, this...
Hold that mic a little bit closer, please.
The United States is the only country in the industrialized world that relies on private, for-profit insurance companies to finance a substantial part of its healthcare system. We spend $1.1 trillion a year in this country for private insurance. $200 billion of that goes for administration, sales and marketing expense, and overhead and profit. If that money were devoted to Medicare, it would be in the $20 to $30 billion incrementally. It's an absurdity, and the reason we do it is because the insurance companies and the pharmaceutical companies spend inordinate amounts of money on lobbying Congress, on public relations campaigns, on corrupting our media so that we don't get the information that we really need to make an intelligent decision as a population.
Don, did you want to add something to what Richard said?
Well, I just think about the future we could have if we really could organize care on behalf of people and communities, really move the money around to where it's really needed, really be transparent about prices and about where the money's flowing and be accountable, we could have a better system. I think it would cost less. I think it would cost substantially less, but even if it cost the same, which I don't think it would perform better. We'd finally have a system that's responsive.
Medicare. We need Medicare for all. All props to Senator Bernie Sanders. Throw the rich out of their hopes. Keep it simple. Have a cultural revolution. Keep it simple.
Smash their glasses.
Smash their glasses. Burn their cars. Keep it simple. That's good. All right. Let's get to the pyramid. So, do you remember how earlier I was talking about unreality and how the Democrats managed to do the worst of both worlds, which is take the risk of a couple of days of bad headlines where people saw a general atmospheric of why are the Democrats shutting down government? I just want people to get along. Now, the desire for people to just get along is far more overstated than most Democratic politicians realize. And of course, their base is becoming increasingly convinced that of course you need full-fledged and aggressive opposition to everything that this thug oligarchic gangster Republican Party is doing, not least of which the terror campaign against immigrants in this country. But the Democrats caved, and in the process of caving, and we'll see. Look, maybe in 3 weeks they'll shut down government again, and or maybe Mitch McConnell will keep his word. Sure, I guess all of those things are possible.
It's been a tough year for you guys. You could have one.
Yeah, you guys want one? You guys were psych. I learned a way of deceiving pussies from the Orient through my wife. Get the fuck out of here. But in times of Democratic wussbagitude, strategic miscalculation, and general dorkish incapacity to either do the morally urgent thing or the strategically ruthless one and doing neither and ending up an incoherent mess, who's going to show up to defend them with the wonkery that it seems so close but yet so far away because it stuck perpetually in 2011 when it was wrong then too? Of course, Ezra Klein. So Democrats didn't cave on the shutdown. Democrats are funding CHIP for 6 years and reopening government without losing their shutdown leverage. Well, CHIP is really important, and theoretically Republicans even themselves said that they supported finding money for it, although they had been only temporarily sort of scrounging for it because it officially ran out of money in September. Theoretically, Republicans supported it, and you could have called them on it. Now, if you don't believe Republicans are committed to giving poor people health insurance, poor children health insurance, I agree with you. I think it's incredibly unlikely that they were going to fulfill their commitment. But they were on record with supporting it, and they did have powerful people like Orrin Hatch, who did, in fact, co-author the program. Now, the leverage the Democrats gave up is that they funded government without any protection for the Dreamers, which they said was their red line. They showed that they have a chunk of their caucus, and not just Trump state Democrats, who will bail out on a bullshit deal which hinges on the word of Mitch McConnell. The same word that told Jeff Flake that there would be a vote on immigration after he voted for the tax giveaway bill. The same one who told Susan Collins that all of her concerns about the ACA repeal portions of the tax bill would be addressed. And then, of course, weren't that same guy, that paragon of honesty and integrity and consistency, Mitch McConnell. So the Democrats rolled. They showed they aren't cohesive within their own caucus. And they're relying on the word of a guy who is less honest than Donald Trump, because at least he like consistently lies versus just having bizarre mood swings inside his soak brain. And then, of course, what will happen is, according to Ezzie, is that the Democrats will be in a great position to exploit this for public relations, as if any of these Republicans, besides maybe a small handful in purple states, and of course no Republican in the House, cares about national numbers on this stuff, when all they have to do is placate a far-right extremist base. Ezra, you don't live in your little West Wing world. That's not where we are. You shouldn't be a grown adult, but yet still young in your mid-30s, standing for Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi. It's sad, and frankly, it's pathetic, and also not good. And that's why Ezra Klein is sentenced to this week's pyramid. Wallahu Akbar. It is done. Man, I love that Egyptian music, man. We got a guest
just
now.
Just another shout out to Derek and Brandon Feitcher.
Derek and Brandon Feitcher.
You have a lot of different, like...
Yeah, you're going to come on.
Things in this theme, yeah.
We do. Those guys are brilliant. Joining us, let me introduce the man before you get camera on him. Joining us now is Anthony Lappé. You might recognize him, patrons, from the illicit history we did on the Bolivian cartel connection, the CIA's drug war in Central America, the Contras, Freeway Ricky Ross. He's a journalist. He's a showrunner. He's known for a lot of things, including Guerrilla News Network, which I know some people in my community are big fans of. But more recently, Vice's Black Market series with Michael K. Williams, and America's War on Drugs, which is a brilliant 8-hour documentary on the History Channel on literally that, but told from a rigorous, non-sugar-coated everything from MK Ultra to the heroin war that's driving our policy in Afghanistan. It's unbelievable. People should check it out. Anthony Lappé, thanks, brother. Thanks for being here.
Hey, it's great to be here.
It's always a pleasure. We've been hanging out for a little while now. We met like in 2014 or something.
That sounds about right.
I feel like, dude, it was Josh Zepps.
That's right.
We were on a Zepps show together.
We the people.
Joshy Zepps, my buddy Josh Zepps. Our buddy Josh Zepps.
He's a big star. He went back to Australia. He's a big star now.
He's back to Australia?
Yeah.
He's not in LA anymore?
No.
I didn't know
he
that.
He got a big big role on radio.
In Australia.
Yeah.
Oh. Well, which by American standards is not a big role. Yeah. I'm just kidding.
You're starting to beef with Australia already? Jeez.
Oh, yeah. No, Australia's been beef with. No, I'm just negging them because I'm so into them. Remember negging?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just nagging Australia. It totally works. Australia's
going to be... You don't hear a lot
Australia's
of that
gonna text me up
in the Me Too era.
I feel like I haven't heard about negging since actually, that when negging came back was during the Trump campaign, and people were like, Trump's actually pretty good at negging. Trump negged the Republican Party.
A guide to negging in the Me Too era.
Guide to negging in the Me Too era. Maybe you wouldn't be saying Me Too if you weren't so ugly. And by the way,
he did move on us like a bitch.
Oh, he really, really did. No, I miss Josh. I loved our arguments. It was I remember just these long shows where he's like, but wouldn't you say, Michael, that the Democrats are losing because you can't make jokes about, fags anymore? And I'm gay, but, it's political correctness. We're going to do a thing that's a little bit more analogous, actually, to some of the illicit history segments. We're going to get into this deep history of the opioid crisis. We're going to break it up into chapters, but let's just do a little preface here. I actually liked what we were talking about this on the phone the other night, and you were saying that partially what this fits into, and partially what Trump actually tapped into, is that the crisis in America, and it always has been in some ways, but it's so bifurcated right now, and that the opioids tracks with the fact that a lot of America actually really is in like carnage.
There are pockets of carnage where the numbers, first off, the opioid epidemic is off the charts. It does not even compare to heroin crises of the past it is on a magnitude greater than the so-called crack epidemic. It's killing now more people than guns and suicide. It is really astronomical, and that's just the deaths, the sort of ongoing carnage of lives destroyed by it, is even greater. But it really is a crisis that is happening in very specific pockets of the country, and pockets that are interestingly don't really get a lot of places like Staten Island here in New York City is, the forgotten borough in rural New Hampshire. And then, of course, it's really hit hardest in Appalachia and Ohio and those areas. So it is a crisis that, sort of in the last year, everyone has woken up to. And it is what I'd like to attempt to do today is to try to draw a through line for people to try to understand how we got here.
Yeah.
And it's a through line that kind of starts in Apocalypse Now, goes weirdly through Afghanistan, the Temple of Dendor at the Met, which is a crazy connection we'll talk about later, through El Chapo, and ending up here through the boardrooms of Big Pharma.
So that the political frame of it, before we get into it, I just really like the way you put it, though, is that like, and of course, like it goes without saying that, of course, Trump and the Republican, I mean, these people, it's a lie. They don't care. It's a scam. But that when the response, and we critique this a lot on this show, when the response to him saying something like that, like we're in carnage, is to be like, well, factually, that's not true.
Middle class.
He is speaking to a very real, and that, of course, doesn't obscure, like, of course, there's a racial hypocrisy that when there was a crack epidemic, we racialized it, and there was no interest in treating people, let alone the underlying conditions. It was all racial war, of course. But to pretend that this isn't a real thing that he's articulating is inhumane and foolhardy.
Yep. And I think it's also tied to the other, interesting part about it, and we'll hopefully end up getting to it
when we
get to this, we'll build our way back up. But it is also tied to the economic situation and the stagnant wages and the sort of hopelessness. What's so interesting about drugs is you can't separate them from the socioeconomic conditions by which people become addicted to drugs and the hopelessness of why you end up, snorting OxyContin when in a hollow in Kentucky.
You create a condition where that's a rational response, not a right response, but that's a completely understandable response to the reality you live in.
Right.
And that's what we miss. So let's go to chapter one.
Yes.
We're back in Laos, the 1960s, the poppy fields. Start us.
So everyone knows about the Vietnam War, and if you even watched Ken Burns' Vietnam, you'd probably learn a lot about it. But even in that series, no one really talked about what was happening in Laos. There was an entire other conflict connected but separate from the war in Vietnam. There was a separate communist insurgency happening in neighboring Laos, and the United States had various treaties that prevented it from actually putting troops on the ground. And it was a situation where Johnson didn't want to get bogged down in another ground war. So basically, this was really one of the CIA's first major counterinsurgency operations. A handful of dudes went up into the mountains in Laos and started fighting a secret, dirty war against the communist insurgents. They teamed up with a local warlord or tribal leader or whatever you want to call him, named Vang Pao, who was kind of a hero of the resistance.
Matt's really into his work.
Vang Pao.
Matt's a big Vang Pao fan. He actually asked if we could get a picture of him.
Oh, he's a badass looking dude.
Yeah, no, I buy it.
So Vang Pao had a fairly cohesive group of fighters, the Hmong Hill people, they're called, in the Aleutian Highlands. And the CIA, led by this guy named Tony Poe, who's this World War II fighter pilot, legendary, you know, part of this first wave of CIA commando dudes that Dulles brought on, really, you know, to fight these dirty wars in the secret. and he basically went into business with Vang Pao. It just so happened that Vang Pao, what people grew in this area was the opium poppy.
Yeah.
So as this secret war progressed and more arms and more planes started flying in, Vang Pao started utilizing the transport planes that were bringing arms, which was run by a secret, not so secret actually, but an airline called Air America, which was a front company for the pretty well known for the CIA, that moved materiel and troops and other things all across Southeast Asia.
Like the CIA is like official, unofficial
exactly,
airline.
Exactly. Okay, yeah, yeah. Like I had my father-in-law was working for USIA, and he went on a mission up in Thailand to like do a study on democracy, and Air America flew him up there, you know? So there's
full service firm. You know, drop the kid off, study some democracy, take some heroin and the
so
other shipment. Yep.
What evolved was essentially a symbiotic relationship between this secret war effort and Vang Pao, where he basically became to the point where he started realizing that they were flying these planes back to bases in Vietnam, South Vietnam and other parts of Southeast Asia. And there were a huge potential customer base in the GIs fighting this war, who, again, what are the conditions in which they were fighting this war? Desperate. All they wanted to do was get away from the current situation they were in. So it created this vicious cycle where Vang Pao's heroin was making its way to the troops. The troops were getting hooked in country, and then they began flying it back. And it became increasingly a giant operation, which in turn connected him to Vang Pao, to the CIA-connected guys who were involved in the French Connection, which had been using Turkish connections from the Fertile Crescent to bring in heroin, and now they connected with the gangsters, Sicilian gangsters, to start bringing it into New York and other places.
And this is like the 60s, 70s, this is like the heroin blow-up.
68, yep. So this leads us to 1970, 71, where there's a major, you know, all these GIs are coming back hooked. You have everyone's seen American Gangster.
Yeah, this is
like
also Frank Lucas story.
Frank Lucas.
Right.
And it was really became the rise, actually, of the first big black gangsters, because prior to this, the Italian mob had really controlled the drug trade. You know, there's a myth, you know, if you watch The Godfather, that the mob didn't touch drugs. That's all a lie. They touched drugs. They wouldn't allow it in their own neighborhoods.
Right.
But a lot of their money came from drugs, than it always had, you know. So Tony Poe is this really interesting character who, in the end, broke with Vang Pao, because he saw that Vang Pao was just really becoming a gangster and not really committed enough to killing communists. And Tony Poe kind of went crazy and left and literally went up the river and basically became the character by which Marlon Brando
now
is based on in Apocalypse Now. Of course, the whole story is based upon Joseph Conrad,
right?
But the actual character that Brando plays is based upon Tony Poe. He went up the river, went crazy, got his own little militia, married a local princess, and kind of that's an incredible story.
So then, that is an unbelievable story. So we have the first heroine,
and
that leads to like just the broader like black mafia, a certain type of musical sound,
police corruption,
all the stuff that people
Serpico
see. Serpico,
comes out.
By
1971, the police, they say, in New York City, were actually the biggest heroin. They actually took over and had made this huge bust of the French Connection heroin, and then but were replacing it with flour and selling it on the streets. It was actually the biggest theft. One single theft in American history was the police stealing $70 million worth of heroin from their own police locker and selling it on the streets. And that was the corruption that Serpico was talking about. And it really had a devastating effect on the police, and it had obviously a devastating effect on the black community. And that was really the first heroin
and across
epidemic.
The whole, yeah. I mean, and that's, yeah, so that's leading. Okay, so that's the first heroin epidemic.
So
let's go.
So,
yeah.
So
yeah,
chapter two.
Yeah, I was going to just say chapter two.
Chapter two, you have to kind of rewind a little bit and set the stage of what's happening in Afghanistan. So Afghanistan has another crazy Cold War related story. Is in the 1950s, Afghanistan is this incredible sort of new great game battleground of influence between the Soviets and Eisenhower. And Eisenhower goes in and launches a gigantic public works program. They give hundreds of millions of dollars worth of aid to Afghanistan. Basically, modern Afghanistan as we know it today, the highways, the dams, the irrigation systems were completely built by American aid money. And the Soviets also, too, but the highways and the ring road around Kabul, whole cities were really built in this effort to, you know, get Afghanistan to be, on our side and not a non-aligned or a Soviet-aligned country. And in the process, by creating this massive industrial agriculture system, they ended up changing the salinity of the soil, by which it created the perfect conditions to grow the opium poppy. So
that's unbelievable.
Opium poppies had always been, you know, grown in Afghanistan. But after that,
like traffickers. Thanks. Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Appreciate it,
so
guys.
So this is another amazing blowback. You can thank the Cold War.
But that's like literally a blowback.
Yeah.
I like that. That's like the physical manifestation of blowback.
So yeah. Simultaneously, as you have, Vang Pao becomes the largest heroin producer in the world, thanks to the CIA. Simultaneously, the what's called the Fertile Crescent up there in Afghanistan, Iran, Afghanistan starts slowly. The opium poppy becomes an increasingly important crop for various local warlords. And as we get into the 70s and the war of the Mujahideen against the Soviets, the Mujahideen in part are funding their operations by selling opium, and
through, of course, like the 80s and early 90s,
exactly.
And that connects with ISI stuff, with the Pakistani intelligence, and we're doing our usual thing where we're just sort of, we're either actively complicit or in the most like sympathetic scenario to U.S. foreign policy, just being like, yeah, well, you know, what are we going to do?
Right.
This is how our allies are going to make money. Let's just not look at it.
Right. So after the Soviets pull out, Afghanistan is a wasteland, and it just, there's different warlords, you know, are fighting for control throughout the 90s. And that's how you see the rise of the Taliban. Now, the rise of the Taliban is a really interesting story, which I found out there's a lot of myths about the Taliban.
Let me just pause you for a second. So the story that I've heard with the Taliban, and this might be one of the myths that's broken up by you, is that in 1996, when they rose to power, that they basically, and they come into a country that literally is like Kabul's like seesawing almost month to month between guys that are willing to shell an entire city to have, I mean, the level of warlordism and disregard for human rights in Afghanistan is like, at the time, was exceptional, and depressingly is a precursor for a lot of stuff we see today.
Yeah.
They came into power, and the story of their founding mythology is that these young religious students who are really tough, and they're trained in Pakistani schools, and they're also trained in like the Pashto fighting traditions, right? That there's a young woman who's murdered and raped by a warlord.
Right.
They come in and they basically hang the guys.
This is the legend.
And the legend is that they came in.
They were the new sheriff in town.
And they also caught the eye in the beginning of American foreign policymakers. The Saudis loved them. And oil companies here loved them because the idea was that these guys might whip the place into shape.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that's in the end. And so part of what they did after 96 up into 98, 99 is promote an idea to the world that they were cracking down on the growing of opium poppy. Right.
And of course, yeah, that heroin. If women can't, you know, wear anything, if there's no television, no music, of course you'd have to crack right. down on heroin, right. right?
So yeah, it was forbidden right. To use. It was locally. They had provisions though that allowed them to sell it to foreigners, and that in turn, you know, caused a huge. They were really slipping it out the back door to Pakistan, and there's a huge heroin epidemic that really emerges in Pakistan. But leading up into the year 2000, they even got the UN and the United States to give them all this money and give them like little, you know, a merit badge for cracking this major crackdown on the growing of opium poppy. The reality is something much different.
Right.
What they did was actually brilliant, which was what they were seeing was there was actually becoming a glut of heroin on the market. There actually wasn't a huge demand. At that point, heroin was not really.
Well, that's another question I have. So, because my perception is that starting certainly in the 80s, but also through the 90s, the heroin became a much less trendy drug.
In the early 90s, it was. I mean, the heroin right. chic and all
okay,
of
so
that.
Okay, so heroin chic came, but
90s.
Not in the 80s,
but not
but early
the, not
90s.
2000 heroin use like in Europe and the US
down.
Was going down. So
okay.
They sort of saw that there was actually a glut and the price was really low. So what they did was they confiscated all of this heroin. They made some, you know, for the cameras, they burnt a couple piles here and there.
Right.
But really what they were doing were stockpiling. So after...
Okay, strategic heroin reserve.
Yeah,
guys,
exactly.
Can I get another beer, please? Thanks.
So yeah. After 9/11, when the U.S. invades... it becomes a huge benefit for them to help in their war effort. And ever since then, basically, you look at 9/11 mm-hmm. and you look at the global output of heroin to the world, it is a hockey stick.
Yeah.
It is, Afghanistan has, more than anything, Afghanistan has become a narco state, and the Taliban have essentially become just no different from the Sinaloa cartel. They pretty much yeah. have lost their religion. They don't really care about religion that much anymore. They're basically, and what's really interesting is it's not just the Taliban. One of the biggest players in this game was Hamid Karzai's brother, Ahmed Karzai, really controlled the movement. He wasn't a grower, but he was the governor of Helmand province. So, Helmand province.
Yeah, yeah.
So
I got
he controlled, you know, nothing moved without his okay, right? And that was completely known by the CIA. He was on the CIA payroll because they were trying to use him because he was also dealing with the Taliban. So they're trying to use him to get the Taliban. So, you know, in part in doing my series on America's War on Drugs, you know, we talked to DEA guys who were like, this was a major battle between these two agencies. And that tension between the CIA and the DEA is a story that, you know, I heard multiple times and in multiple places. So that is one part of the story of this global rise of heroin. Chapter
three. Well, right yeah. before we get to chapter sure. three, I just want to take a brief moment. I want to remind myself that Nation of Islam Obama issuing a fatwa that you can sell heroin to infidels is absolutely a future sketch on the show. I just want to index that. I think that's brilliant. Like, according to Hadith, the animal could take it. I want to do it like Obama could have the Godfather scene. Let white people take the drugs. They have no souls. Let them poison themselves. They have no souls anyway. Does chapter three take us to the corporate connection?
Yes.
Yet? Okay,
exactly.
So chapter, I want to set that up because right. I just think that chapter three is fascinating because we have the connection between underworld and overworld that always gets exposed in U.N.'s foreign policy and the CIA.
Yeah.
But now when we're talking about opioids, we realize that, and you know, I think you'd be careful. Like in my field and with my politics, I'm always talking about the criminality of capitalism, the cruelty of corporations. And, you know, and at times I think you have to be careful and not be hyperbolic. So a company can be disgusting and destroy many lives, but they are not literally a organized crime outfit in the sense that we use it.
Right.
When we get to opium or opioids, we really have to start looking at pharma and these companies as like there is not. We could start using
the
most hyperbolic language in a way that's simply accurate. Take us to chapter three.
Yeah, I mean, just on that point, if you ask any pharmacologist or any neuroscientist, they will tell you the difference between OxyContin and heroin that you buy on the street is basically just two things. Number one, it's a lot more pure and it's better.
The OxyContin. Right.
Shit you buy on the street is like, could be adulterated with anything. It could kill you. And it's, you know, probably is a lot less potent, though now it's gotten very potent because there's lots of synthetics that are mixed in. But that's, we'll get to that.
Yeah, we'll get to that. But, we've seen a lot.
But secondly, really the only other difference is it's just formulated in a sort of slow release format. And it's just a different delivery system, right? It is literally the same. It's not like, you know, some of these where, you know, Adderall is very, very similar to meth, right?
It's a different drug. It's not the same thing.
It's not the same thing.
Right.
This is, if you ask any pharmacologist, there is not a big difference between what it's doing to your brain when you take OxyContin and when you take heroin. It's just how it's delivered, how quick it hits you, you know, all those things. But it's hitting the same parts of your brain.
Right.
It's doing the same things. So
chapter three, the corporate chapter connection.
Chapter three in the Temple of Dendor. That's my favorite part of
it. I love it.
So basically, there's a company called Purdue Pharmaceuticals, and they were run for years by a family called the Sacklers. And they were a guy who, they're not, the founder of this epic family legacy was basically a marketing guy who was a genius in writing. He was really like the Don Draper of pharmaceutical marketing. He was the guy who invented the idea of marketing directly to physicians in journals where you could. So he was, and so during the 1970s, he was writing the marketing copy for Valium that got literally a generation hooked on Valium. They would have ads in magazines with like college freshmen saying basically, the pressures of her first year can be overwhelming. Valium is the answer for, you know, like every college freshman should have a Valium on hand to get them over, you know, the finals jitters, you know. And the social pressures of freshman year. I mean, so this guy was, coming out of this marketing genius, he ended up taking over a small, somewhat random pharmaceutical company called Purdue, that was like making laxatives or something. And they ended up coming up with a morphine pill, which again is basically, again, morphine, heroin, OxyContin, all the same thing, all coming from the opium poppy derivative, all having a similar effect on the body.
Is the pivot.
Yeah, the pivot was
a pivot from laxatives to heroin.
And then
I've got the copy written.
Then they basically realized that the big problem with these pills were that you would have to take a lot of them. And it was, if you had, you're dealing with pain management. Usually, you know, traditionally opioids were used for post-surgery pain management. When you're in a lot of pain, you had a hip transplant. And so they're very hard because they went very fairly quick. Their big, invention was to figure out a way to make it a sort of time release pill. And they claimed.
And this is OxyContin.
And that is OxyContin.
Okay.
Again, not a big difference to any of the other pills that have been out there. But it basically, they marketed it as a 12-hour pill that you could take at night and then get up in the morning. And for the most part, it sort of worked. Now, anyone who knows anything about opioids and heroin or anything is you develop a resistance or a what's the word I'm looking for?
Tolerance.
Thank you. Yeah. Tolerance to these things very quickly.
Right.
I mean, there are people, you know, you can take, if you're a virgin to it, you take two pills and be looped off your head. I have friends who had surgery and got hooked and were taking 30, 40 pills.
A day,
right.
Yep.
You can, the limits of your body, what when it starts numbing your endorphin receptors. Right. So what happens is people started to really realize that, it didn't really last for 12 hours. And they also realized that if you ground it up, because, and it literally, this was the crazy part, on their the label, it said, warning, don't grind this up because it will make it super powerful and may kill you. Which of course is
right,
like,
which is literally like the instruction manual. Right. And so at the same time, they're also pioneering the methodology of talk to
the marketing.
Right. Yeah, the marketing.
So they have armies.
So they've done the tech.
Right.
And the now, tech is make this the most pleasurable, deliverable, right, addictive. And now let's not just sort of, you know, say like, hey, this was available for people with surgery. Right. Let's get this out there.
So they have, you know, they really perfected having an army of marketers, particularly young, cute women, going around the country, giving, you know, first ones free, like every classic cliche drug dealer, giving out free samples to physicians, figuring out all these like weasel words to get around the fact that, you know, saying it's virtually non-addictive and things like that. Like literally having a manual of things to legally say, even though everyone, every farm, you know, anyone who knows anything about opioids and opium and heroin, it is some of the most addicting substances on earth.
Right.
I mean, really, if you get down to it, drugs like cocaine, frankly, are not technically addictive. You psychologically, you can get addicted to it, and you can feel like shit if you don't get some coke, if you start doing it for a while.
And but heroin and opioids have a different, they have like a literal physiological.
You can almost die by coming down off the pain involved. If you are a serious heroin addict, can in fact kill some people, and it is some of the most, like, to, if when you're severely addicted, coming down off it and getting off it can be some of those painful things you will ever do. So they launch this massive marketing campaign, and then you have a number of states with very loose laws around how prescriptions and doctors work together. Florida being the most egregious example. Florida, basically, anyone can open up a doctor's office and a pharmacy in the same building and not have any medical training yourself.
Right.
So basically what you have is this explosion of what are called pill mills, where they have these, like, the famous one are these two brothers who start these pill mills called American Pain. And they have like scores of, they're basically,
it sounds like such a like bad like 90s like kind of like,
yeah,
American Pain, blah, 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 blah.
They were basically these jacked up steroid heads who realized there's this incredible, and they had the doctors literally were their hands were cramping, so they gave them stamps to sign it. The average meeting with a doctor was like under 3 minutes. And they had at one point a mobile MRI in the parking lot of a strip club where you could go. And it was like, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but the number, you know, the astronomically, the number of prescriptions that were given or pills that were dispensed in Florida, you know, vastly outstripped the rest of the country. Right. So you had people all over the Eastern Seaboard driving down to Florida, buying these up, and became, you know, there became a robust black market for in the early 2000s for OxyContin pills.
And this is all coming through Purdue and through the Sackler family. Exactly. Now, then there's two other pieces that I want to get to with the Sacklers, the Met connection that you've been teasing.
So the Sacklers,
and then also I'll just give this tease. One of the great sleaze bags of American political history.
Oh, yes.
As well.
Oh, God. How can we almost forget him?
Yeah.
So the Sacklers, at the same time, they are literally revolutionizing the marketing of heroin, essentially, in pill form. They are also one of the country's biggest benefactors. They're like somewhat like the Cokes, you know?
Right.
They literally are the Sackler Wing in the Metropolitan Museum of Art is where the Temple of Dendor is.
Yep.
You know, amazing colonial plunder.
Yep.
And many other institutions of higher learning and museums have Sackler Wings and Sackler this and Sackler. I mean, they have given.
I've definitely seen a Sackler Wing. I don't even remember where, but exactly. There's not, I've definitely seen that name
somewhere. A lot of wings. Yeah. And at the same time, they are like many other companies, like the tobacco industry and others, when they're under fire, hire high-priced former political hitmen to tried to mitigate some of the increasing number of lawsuits by state attorney generals, right. attorneys general, and individuals who are suing them for negligence and for pushing these pills. Of course, one of those is probably one of your favorite mayor in mind.
Oh, yeah.
Rudy Giuliani.
Yeah, it's great. Mm-hmm. Rudy Giuliani, who, I mean, mm-hmm. I wasn't here. I wasn't, 18 yet, but I have a memory of Rudy. And the thing that I tell people, I guess everybody knows he's a scumbag now just from present exposure.
Oh, and Bernie Kerik was part of it too.
Oh, and Bernie Kerik.
Yes.
You should remind everybody who Bernie Kerik was. I'll just say, among many things about Rudy Giuliani, this was a guy who after, I think it was Abner Louima, was killed by New York police officers. He was supposedly, it was reaching for a wallet. They pumped him with like over 30 bullets. He said there was a leak inside his administration of this guy's juvenile record, which had nothing to, beyond nothing to do. That was one case. And then another case where I think Giuliani personally said of somebody else, maybe the same guy, could be mixing up cases, he wasn't a choir boy.
After
killed unarmed by police. Yeah. There were record, accusations. So this guy also built his career on prosecuting drug cases.
Exactly.
Right. So he, and then Bernie Kerik, was
a former police chief who was disgraced and did time in prison.
He did time in prison, yeah.
For various things, one of which was he was using an apartment over the World Trade Center, wreckage for basically...
to fuck his book agent.
Yeah, to bang his book agent.
Yeah.
That was supposed to be used for first responders to get a break.
He probably considered himself a first responder.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I'm getting a break, and I'm a first responder, fucking my book agent. Great.
So what you have...
I love when these people are out there that remind you, even if you can be a little shady, you're like, wow, I'm actually a pretty good person. The people out there doing some real scumbag shit, man. If you read about Giuliani and those people, you're like, these are just really bad humans.
Yeah.
So Giuliani and Bernie Kerik, they're doing consulting.
They're helping them out, fight all this stuff. Finally, around 2010-ish, they finally get Purdue. Purdue starts losing its copyright on it. It's part of it. But they also get Purdue to change it so that you can't break up the pill into powder form and snort it. They put it in a little jelly form. It makes it harder.
So they restricted their free market activity there.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and totally unfair.
And states start cracking down. They start putting some of these pill mill guys and the American Pain guys go to prison. Doctors are getting busted for... So what happens is... It really contracts this black market. You can't go in and just get a script really easily anymore.
Right.
And around the same time, another thing is happening.
This is about to be chapter 4.
Chapter 4.
So, but just really quickly before we get to chapter 4, are the heirs to this Sackler fortune? Could we have run into them in any obnoxious Williamsburg parties or anything?
Well, that's what's interesting about them is they keep super on the DL. They have, they
I would too.
Are like, they
it's like all of the largesse was built on mass scale human misery. Yeah. I would be like, man.
One of them is a Brooklyn artist, but
nailed it.
He denies having any of profiting at all somehow from all this. The other
I don't profit. I just have a couple of brownstones and pursuing my music. Prick.
They
trust funds and inheritance should be abolished. Period. Let alone from that. But anyways, I'm sure the guy's music is great.
Yeah, I'm sure it's good.
If he did like heroin music, that would be cool. If he did like 70s style, like he wrote like odes to Frank Lucas homage, and stuff. Yeah. He just did like heroin beats. Now, at least he would have a sense of irony, but he probably does like sad stuff about breaking up with MFA students or something. I'm just assuming this guy's garbage. Okay. Chapter 4. I could be wrong. He could be a great guy. Cares. Could be a great.
Exactly.
Oh, you have met them at Williamsburg bad parties, haven't you? Look at Anthony. No comment.
I'm not gonna comment on someone I don't know.
Hey, look. Right. Heroin heirs. No, I'm just kidding. They're not bringing us their best. No, I'm just joking. I'm totally joking. So. But more importantly than the people, the joking aside, their largesse is institutionally all over the place.
It's all over the place.
And that is relevant. It's besides
like
they're the
jokes. Like, exactly.
So chapter 4.
Chapter 4
begins actually with a little bit of good news.
Well, yeah, right. Yeah. So there's a somewhat tragic and paradoxical outcome of one of the more positive trends that we've had in this country over the last decade, which is the legalization of pot in various states, from recreational to medicinal use. So what a lot of people don't realize about the Mexican cartels is up until this point, we're talking 2008, 2009, 2010, up to 30 to 40% of their profits were made from pot. Mexican weed really was like a lot of the southern parts of the country were inundated with Mexican weed. There, the Durango around in province, a lot of, there's huge, you know, traditional pot trade. There was a lot of pot was grown in the Mexican mountains and it would make its way to the United States. Almost overnight, the legalization of pot and just the growth of the indoor movement and also just the quality of American pot, right, just goes through the roof. And the cartels are not...
They take prepared. A hit.
They take a huge hit. Their weed sucks, basically.
Right.
And they can't compete.
And going back to high school, everybody's like, oh, is that Mexican weed? That's terrible. Right.
Yeah. They never was... It was always quantity over quality when it came to Mexican weed. This was like
Walmart weed.
Yeah. So these guys were not artisans. Let's put it that way. When it came to
they
weed.
Were not. Not fair.
Tequila, mezcal. They were a little.
Oh, you know, that's their specialty.
They're better at it. Right, yeah. Right. So what happens is, the cartels are like, well, all right, well, like we're not going to just lose 30 to 40% of our profits. Let's pivot to video.
Exactly.
So they literally almost overnight, ramp up, because there's also parts of Mexico are great for opium poppy as well. Ramp, and they always had Mexican black tar heroin. There was always, a heroin trade and growth of the opium poppy in Mexico.
But they get a lot more serious about improving the quality and the purity.
And they really take a page out of the Sackler-Purdue book, and they launch essentially a gigantic marketing campaign where they send the different cartels, mostly Sinaloa.
That is El Chapo's cartel. Exactly. And this is a cartel that with at least, again, they're complicit. United States and Mexican governments have let Sinaloa dominate. Similarly, if you follow like the Cali cartel in Colombia in the 80s and 90s, there was a perception that, oh, these guys are a little more reasonable.
Right.
They're a little bit less violent, which is an extremely relative way of putting it. And they were certainly, both through corruption and through just sort of political calculations, allowed to rise.
Right. They were theoretically, like, say, the Taliban back in the day, like, they could be the sheriffs and be the big dogs and keep Mexico from becoming a war of all against, 10 cartels. They were the mega cartel at that point. So they were pretty much El Chapo's in the right place at the right time to capitalize on this massive demand, where you had all these pockets around the country where people were all, in a matter of a year or so, cut off from their supply of pills. So the cartels sent out representatives and they started, really good quality heroin, and went out, and guys basically were like, okay, pills, the price for pills were going up to like $50 a pill, or you could get a bag of heroin for $20, right? So all of a sudden, you have this flip-flop from pills to heroin, and the cartels are just massively taking advantage of this. And, people who were hooked were somewhat, just basically pawns in their hands because they were, you know, physically addicted to this drug. And that, and it all, and it happened, you know, in somewhat quietly, again, going back to your opening point, the in places that, you know, are
the peripheries.
Yeah, we're not seeing that happening. When I live in Manhattan and I'm covering the stuff, you're not seeing it. It's happening to Italian guys in Long Island and in Staten Island. It's happening to, you know, the sons of former coal miners in Kentucky, and guys who, you know, used to work in the kids whose parents worked in the factories that closed down in Ohio. So all these, you can look at where these pockets of heroin have come up, and it really does track where your unemployment, desperation, the post-industrial economy, you know, kind of hit hard. So that is basically the situation that leads us up to our current situation.
And then let's do a little chapter five. So that means that, you know, taking us back to the beginning, that means that, again, and it's totally cynical and totally racist, but whether we're talking about the way Breitbart turned the cartel wars into like a, you know, xenophobic day by day, minute by minute tabloid coverage, you see hints of it on Fox News, but it's really perfected in that Breitbart model, like I think in really like 2014, 2015. Mm-hmm. And all of this stuff that Trump was talking about, people identified the xenophobia, they identified the racism, but they were definitely disconnected, just as they were, of course, disconnected from the larger reality that neoliberal economics was not working, that the recovery was a complete fantasy for most people, that the recovery money was massively disproportionate in terms of where it went on the economic scale. So that then you have this, a con man can come along but articulate a reality that nobody else is articulating.
Yep.
And that's where we're at.
Yep.
So like then in this moment now, like, actually, of course, once he's in office, he's cutting funding to treat opioids.
Right.
There isn't...
Isn't Kushner... And that's one of
That's one of his many...
That's his part of his portfolio, is to solve the opioid crisis.
I have never seen...
Has he done it yet? Is he on it?
I think he's a little bit...
He's a little behind.
As soon as Israeli-Palestinian peace is established, which is probably another week or so, and then he got to sort of like smooth some things out with China,
yeah,
and we'll be on the opioid crisis.
Right. Right. I think, didn't he have to, he was like revolutionizing something else. What was the other thing he was doing?
Something about computers or some shit. Do we have that sound drop of him? We have a Kushner. I have never seen, like, my experience of Jared Kushner is being completely ready to be completely, like, you know, less than unimpressed by him. And then the extent to which I've been unimpressed by him still exceeded my already completely contemptuous, trust fund baby.
He had it going so well when he didn't say anything. And then these little clips of him, and you hear what a weenie he is. Like, what just an idiot that he, you know, it's just like, just, you had it, you were playing it so smart. He had that self-awareness to not
do this.
Yeah, to not, whatever he's about
to say. It's working, and it's very exciting.
He looks a bit Wallace and Gromit when he says that, actually.
He looks a bit inbred when he says that, actually.
It's working, and it's very exciting.
I think the brilliant thing, I think what actually might have gotten him to talk was the money move that John Oliver did, where he dubbed like a 2010 interview with Gilbert Gottfried.
Do we still have that?
I think if we could find that would be incredible. It's like Kushner sitting in that like stilted weird way of his on like CNBC or something, explaining like, you know, his brilliant move to like own the New York Observer, right, or whatever nonsense expedition that he was on. Like the money has fried his brain, and still like kissing and calling his dad daddy. And he said, and he goes, he's like, you know, he just said something like, I've invested in real estate and a variety of other blah blah blah. Oh yeah, we have this. Let's enjoy this for a moment. I think this forced Jared to speak, and Gottfried was actually better.
Again, my main business is real estate. I also own a newspaper and some other websites and online media businesses.
You don't know for a fact that that is not his actual voice.
He sure is pretty, though. I mean, look at that.
You think so?
He's pretty good. He's pretty.
Oh, we have different perceptions. all right, everybody. We are going to go to the post game. That was the treatment.
We did it.
We did it. We nailed it.
Yeah.
We did it.
We even added another bonus chapter.
We absolutely
had
did.
Four.
We fucking nailed
it. You went
it.
To but five.
We did it. It's working. And it's very exciting. As I said to everybody, we exceeded 1,000 patrons. I thank all of you. Democrats fold constantly, but we don't. I love having you be my constituents, basically, being accountable to you. We're growing. We're going to do the animation soon. We are on the move. You get more than twice the content as a patron. So do it. Patreon.com/TMBS. Anthony Lappé is hanging out with me through the post game. I want to thank him for being here.
And for being a patron.
And for being a patron. That's right.
I'm proud of you, man. 1,000, that's great.
I really appreciate it, man.
It's really, people are talking about you, man.
They are. And it's mostly.
I didn't tell you what they're saying.
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't want to know. I'll just stick with they're talking. I'm like Trump that way. They say good things about me, I say good things about them. So thank you, Anthony. I want to thank super producer Matt Leck, super producer David Slavik, head theoretician David Grishkin. We'll be back in about 5 minutes at the post game. Thanks, everybody.